So it's been my mission since I discovered what the Battle of Newmarket Heights actually was to try to raise awareness of it, because when I found out about it, and maybe you've shared this experience, you hear about this battle right on the doorstep of the Confederate Capitol. Everybody in the tip of the spear is a black soldier, a lot of them former slaves, some of them slaves that were born near Richmond, now fighting for their the freedom of their loved ones back at home, just not too far from where they were born into bondage, going up against some of the best troops in Robert E. Lee's army and winning. And 16 of them win the Medal of Honor, and nobody talks about it, and a movie hasn't been made about it. You just kind of are like, what? How have I not heard about this? Where has this been all my life? And that's kind of how I felt. And ever since then, I've just been trying to raise awareness through the book and then through the organization that is currently trying to raise money to put a statue on the battlefield. So has anybody ever seen this photograph before?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that's one of the few photographs that you'll see of black soldiers that served during the Civil War. And if you don't know, black soldiers that served from 1863 on were organized into what were called United States Colored Troops. And that's pretty much one of the only photographs that you see of them. I mean, obviously, since the 150th anniversary, there's been a lot more coming out. The Library of Congress has some really amazing photographs. But for a long time, that was kind of the standard go-to group image of blacks in uniform. It's in the Ken Burns series. And it turns out those are all veterans of Newmarket Heights. So that worked out in my favor. So that's, yeah, those are, that's Company E of the 4th United States Colored Infantry, which is a Maryland unit. And that's them in the defenses of Washington, D.C. in 1865, I believe in February. So yeah, so it's also on the cover of my book. And it's a great photograph because there's this one guy in the photograph who's just got this, like, he's giving you the worst stink eye you've ever seen. Like, I think in the Ken Burns series, they actually zoom in on his face and his hat's cocked back at a really jaunty angle, and he's just kind of squinting at you. So probably because of what he saw during his time in combat. But so as I said, you know, I have the notes in front of me to keep me moving in the right direction. So. If you're not familiar with what the Battle of Newmarket Heights is and the kind of the bigger context in which it takes place, I'm going to push a button. Hey, it worked. All right. Okay, so this is going to take place in a larger series of battles that really begins in March of 1864 when Ulysses S. Grant is going to come east. You know, he had been serving as an army commander out in the West, winning victories at Vicksburg and Chattanooga. And because of his victory at Chattanooga, Lincoln brings him to the Eastern Theater to appoint him to the rank of lieutenant general. And he's going to be given command of all Union forces. And he's going to basically make his headquarters with the main Union army in the Eastern Theater, the Army of the Potomac. And he's going to launch this series of battles that's going to be come to be known as the Overland Campaign, that starts at the Battle of the Wilderness. It took place not too far from where I live, at Fredericksburg, in May of 1864. And it's going to involve not only the Army of the Potomac, but several other Union forces as well, one of which is going to fight in the Shenandoah Valley in May at the Battle of Newmarket. But we're done talking about them. So there's this whole other army called the Army of the James, and it's commanded by Benjamin Franklin Butler. And its mission during this overall campaign, so you know, the Army of the Potomac is up there where you see it, where it says Grant. They're going to start off north of Richmond, and Butler's Army of the James is going to be sent to directly threaten the city of Richmond at the same time. So Grant's big idea is that if you're threatening as many major cities or major points of interest for the Confederate forces, you're going to tie them up and be able to take advantage of your numerical superiority. So that's Grant's idea. Butler, you know, kind of fumbles the ball in his initial attempts to besiege Petersburg and take the city of Richmond. So that's going to fail, but that's the larger context. So you have the Army of the Potomac is going to fight its way all the way down near Richmond. They're going to be stymied at a place called Cold Harbor in June of 1864. And then they're going to sidestep, as you see from that bottom large blue arrow, the sidestep the city of Richmond and invest the city of Petersburg, which is the main supply line to Lee's army in the city of Richmond. And when they do that, they're going to establish a bridgehead at a place called Deep Bottom. And that's going to come into play for the story of New Market Heights. So what Deep Bottom is it's a place where the bottom of the river is deep. That's why they called it that. They were, didn't take much to name a place back then. But that's sort of a close-up view there of where the bend in the river takes place. And it's a great place to establish some pontoon bridges. So those are the portable bridges that are actually still used by the military to this day. You can lay them down very quickly and then take them right back up. And the pontoon bridges at Deep Bottom are going to be used to threaten the city of Richmond. So Grant, as I said, he realizes that he has numerical superiority. So what he does is he uses the main army, the Army of the Potomac, to threaten the city of Petersburg. And whenever he launches a main attack against the city of Petersburg, he simultaneously launches an attack east of Richmond. So that attack is going to be launched north of the James, and that's going to be at Deep Bottom. So it's going to be Butler's army, basically, that's responsible for threatening Richmond, while it's George Meade's Army of the Potomac that's going to be responsible for threatening the city of Petersburg. So starting in June, there's going to be a series of battles that take place, June, July, August, where there's going to be efforts against Petersburg with efforts made against Richmond at the same time. So you've probably heard of the Battle of the Crater, because there's a large contingent of African American troops that are going to be involved in that battle. An entire division, the only black troops in the Army of the Potomac, are going to be sent into the mine attack there right outside of Petersburg on July 30th, 1864. Well, there's a whole other effort north of the James that most people don't know about, and it doesn't get a lot of coverage. But that's going to happen over a series of days in July 1864, the first Battle of Deep Bottom, which I also wrote a book about. So this is sort of the way things are going in the summer of 1864. There's going to be a second effort launched against Richmond, interestingly enough named the Second Battle of Deep Bottom after the first Battle of Deep Bottom failed. So. You don't have to wonder about what these names mean. So that's going to be August of 1864. So there's sort of been an established pattern. And Grant's going to get intelligence in mid to late September of 1864 that Robert E. Lee is going to be shifting some of his forces to the Shenandoah Valley. And he sees that as an opportunity to once again threaten both of these cities, Petersburg and Richmond. So once again, he's going to call upon Butler and his Army of the James. And that army has the largest contingent of African American troops, also called United States Colored Troops. And we'll talk a little bit more about them now. So that's kind of the context in which this is all taking place. Let me skip ahead here. So this is Butler. You've probably seen his image. Somebody who's kind of universally hated. That's slowly changing. But I know that when I first got interested in the Civil War, you're not going to find many people that had anything nice to say about Benjamin Franklin Butler. But he's in command of the Army of the James. And as I said, he's got two divisions worth of United States Colored Troops at his disposal. So over 10,000 black soldiers are under his command. And to go back a little bit about sort of how the United States Colored Troops came to be, this is all a result of the Emancipation Proclamation. There's a line in there that talks about African Americans being permitted to join the land and naval forces of the United States. In May of 1863, you're going to have what's called the Bureau of Colored Troops established. And it's their job to recruit and raise United States Colored Troops units throughout the country. And they were headquartered in Philadelphia. And so you're going to have all of these regiments organized, and they're federal regiments. Okay, so federal regiments had numerical designations. So that's why it kind of sounds strange that if you go to most Civil War battlefields, you're learning about the 21st Virginia, or you know, some other unit like that has a state designation, or the 54th Massachusetts, whereas all these United States Colored Troops units are the 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and that's because they are part of the Federal Army. The 54th Massachusetts is the only black unit that is allowed to keep its state designation in terms of infantry. There's a few more, but most of them are going to be converted. So like, you know, the 3rd South Carolina, I believe, turns into the 79th United States Colored Troops. But the idea is that you're recruiting these men into the Army, and I'd say about it's pretty evenly split in terms of half of them had been former slaves, and half of them more or less were free men of color who were volunteering to fight. You're going to have about 187,000 of them join the Union Army during the Civil War. 10% of the entire army by war's end will be African American. And these are the forerunners of the Buffalo Soldiers units that are going to come into existence just a few years after the Civil War. And they're going to stick around until World War II, believe it or not. So there's a pretty immediate legacy of the U.S. Colored Troops. Now, so as I said, 10% of the Union Army, about 37,000 of that 187,000 are going to die during the war. So that's a pretty high percentage. Some of that is due to disease. The majority of it is due to disease, but some of it's also due to the fact that these are black soldiers. So how do you think the Confederate States of America reacted when they found out that that Lincoln and the United States Army and the War Department were arming African Americans? Do you think they viewed that? Yeah. Exactly. Your laugh says it all. They did not view this very favorably. I'll just put it that way. So they're viewing this as John Brown on a massive scale. Nat Turner on a massive scale. This is like their worst nightmare. And you know, sometimes you read their accounts and like you get the sense that they actually believe their nonsense about how like, you know, the slaves were happy and you know, kind of better off, and you know, we just can't understand why they would want to run away and fight us. So some of them reacted that way. The Confederate government tried to stamp this down pretty quickly. They said that any black soldier caught, or they didn't really recognize them as soldiers, but they said any black caught wearing a blue uniform is going to be immediately returned to a state of slavery. Didn't matter if he was a free black from the North, he was going to be enslaved. And then initially they said that white officers were going to be handed over to the states to be dealt with, whatever state they were captured in. But then they changed their mind in 1862 and said that any white officer is basically going to be executed for inciting slave rebellion. There's that famous scene in Glory in the Rain where Shaw reads that proclamation from the Confederate government. So it's not like these guys didn't know what they were getting into when they joined up. So, I mean, factor that into the amount of bravery it took to participate in the attack that I'm about to describe. But I found this quote, and I just couldn't pass up relaying it to you. So this was a letter written to a Confederate soldier in the trenches outside of Richmond. And it's from his wife, and his wife is reacting to the news that the Lincoln and the War Department are arming black soldiers, and that these black soldiers are now being actively deployed on the battlefield. This is her encouragement to him. She says, "Shoot them, dear husband, every chance you get. They are devil furies who thirst for your blood and who will revenge themselves upon your helpless wife and children. It is God's will and wish for you to destroy them. You are his instrument, and it is your Christian duty." So she sounds like a lot of fun. So, but I mean, I say that, but these Confederate soldiers, as we'll see in a minute, they didn't need any encouragement. They took matters into their own hands quite a bit. So, all that's sort of the context for, you know, the men that are in Butler's army, and the importance of the attack that they're going to participate in So let me go back and give you what it's like here. So the units that are manning the trenches and then the units that are going to be making the attack at New Market Heights. So on the north side of the James, you have what's called the Department of Richmond. And it's been around since 1862 when McClellan's army first threatened Richmond. And it's kind of, you know, the rear echelon types. You know, it's not the guys at the tip of the spear with Lee's army. It's clerks, you know, in the War Department who are going to be called upon at a moment's notice to, you know, man the trenches or man the battle line, kind of like the Minutemen. Or units that maybe had suffered a lot in combat and were trying to recoup their strength, they're going to put them in this more quiet sector. So it's commanded by that guy on the left, Richard Ewell, who had been a pretty well-regarded Confederate officer. He served under Stonewall Jackson, and he actually takes over Jackson's corps when Jackson is killed at Chancellorsville. He disappoints Robert E. Lee pretty substantially during the Battle of the Wilderness, and then again, really, at Spotsylvania Courthouse in May of 1864, and that's going to result in him getting booted to the Department of Richmond. The gentleman in the middle there is John Gregg. He's in command of a force known as the Texas Brigade. And in 1862, this force was commanded by John Bell Hood. So Hood's Texas Brigade, like the cream of the crop. These are the toughest soldiers in Robert E. Lee's army. Now, I should say that by September of 1864, they also have had a really horrible experience both at the Wilderness and at Spotsylvania Courthouse. And they've taken severe casualties. But that doesn't mean that those that were still fit to fight were not, you know, the same caliber of troops that they had always been. And then you're going to have some cavalry, the Hampton Legion, pretty famous Confederate unit under the command of Martin Gary there, the guy on the right. He's a Confederate officer that most people haven't heard of, but knew his stuff. He was a Harvard graduate, pretty smart guy. Nickname was the Bald Eagle, for obvious reasons. So these are all either officers that still were or had been very effective leaders on the battlefield that are manning this sector for the most part. Now there's also the commander of the artillery in this sector was John Pemberton, who was the Confederate general that had surrendered Vicksburg. He was good buddies with Jefferson Davis, and that was pretty much the only reason he was allowed to stay in command of anything. But so you do have some officers of questionable skill, I guess, but you know, not second-rate troops for the most part manning the New Market line. So we talked about Butler a little bit and his subordinate officers there. So the Army of the James, much smaller army than the Army of the Potomac, only about 37,000 men, two corps of infantry, the 10th and the 18th, and then there's a division of cavalry. They're the ones that are going to be involved in the attack on New Market Heights. So let's zoom in on one division of the 18th Corps commanded by Charles Jackson Payne, because this entire division is made up of USCTs. So this is an all-black division with the obvious exception of the officers. So these are the men that are going to be put in the vanguard of the attack at New Market Heights. And it's a very intentional thing, as we'll talk about in a minute. So Payne, from Massachusetts, friends with Butler. And Butler, if you don't know him, wow, it's very hard to like give you a quick version of Benjamin Franklin Butler. He's a politician. He's not a general. He is a diehard Democrat when the war begins. He nominates at the Democratic Convention of 1860 Jefferson Davis to be the party nominee. Okay, so that kind of gives you an idea of his political leanings at the beginning of the war. But then when the war starts, he realizes it's an opportunity for him. So he becomes a major general of volunteers. Yeah, he's responsible for rescuing the city of Baltimore in April of 1861. And that's, you know, it's a good start. But then he kind of has a checkered experience when he goes down to New Orleans, where he insults the women of New Orleans by they were abusing federal troops, and he put out this proclamation that said any woman caught abusing Union soldiers will be treated as a woman of the night plying her trade, which I think is the direct quote. basically insulting the honor of Southern womanhood, which, you know, he didn't do. So he actually had a price on his head, which is why he is not leading the attack on New Market Heights from the front lines. He runs up and gives them a rousing speech, and then he goes right back to the rear. Can't say I blame him. But still, by 1864, has really evolved. If you've ever heard of the contraband policy at Fortress Monroe, he's the general that institutes that policy where Southern slaves aren't going to be returned to their masters. They're going to be treated as contraband of war and then put to work in the Union lines. So by the war's end, he's really kind of a radical Republican. And he turns into a arch nemesis of anybody who defended the Southern Confederacy when he's in Congress after the war. So he's in command, but as I said, he's a politician, more of a politician than a general. Payne here is friends with him. He's only 28 years old, and he's a brigadier general. And then his two subordinates there are Alonzo Draper and Samuel Duncan. Okay, so these are the people that are going to be involved in the attack. So let's get to the idea behind the attack in the first place. And I'm going to step away here just so you can kind of see what was in play. So this main road that you see that kind of cuts through the top of the map there is the New Market Road. And there's a hill just on the other side of it there where it says Signal Hill. Those heights are called New Market Heights. So the red line there is a Confederate trench, a line of fortifications that was built to protect that road, because that road is one of the main eastern approaches to the Confederate capital at Richmond. So pretty important road. It's kind of hard to see, but you can see that there's some creeks and some water. We'll talk about that in a minute, but that's really going to come into play during the attack. So let me fast forward here so you can see a close-up of the line. So the New Market line, you can see, commanded on either side by Confederate artillery. And these weren't any slouch Confederate units. It's the Richmond Howitzers and the Rockbridge Artillery, two of the best. So the line is anchored on either end by artillery. So they've kind of created a fatal funnel, to use a modern military term, where they're you really kind of only have one avenue of approach, and they've already kind of got that, staked out in terms of where their fields of fire are going to be. And then you can see the Hampton Legion, 7th South Carolina, 24th Virginia. Those are all cavalry units, or dismounted cavalry, and then the 1st, 4th, 5th Texas, and 3rd Arkansas, all part of the Texas Brigade. So, like I said, this is a formidable line that these U.S. colored troops are going to be going up against. And out in front of the line are basically the 1800s equivalent of barbed wire. So barbed wire isn't invented until after the Civil War. So they had wooden obstructions, slashing, abatis. You can kind of see here the general gist of how a fortification is going to be laid out. You have the tops of trees cut down, their branches are interlocked, and then you have a ditch, and then you have the guys on the other side in the trenches shooting at you. So the idea is to slow you down while the guys in the trenches are able to just shoot you, kind of at their own discretion. So this is something that had been perfected by 1864. And unfortunately, it's going to be one of the main deciding factors of how the first attack at New Market Heights develops, I guess. So, once again, in September of 1864, as I said, Grant is going to launch one of these, what they were called double enders, where you attack at Petersburg and then attack at Richmond. And Butler is going to be responsible for figuring out how he wants this attack to go. And as I mentioned at the beginning, the July 1864 Battle of the Crater, black troops got a bad rap after that battle. And they were blamed in a lot of circles for the failure of that attack, even though it had nothing to do with them and everything to do with the generals and officers that were in charge of them. Still, the popular perception was that it was the black soldiers that had fumbled the ball. So Butler knew that, and he wanted to give them a chance to redeem themselves. So when he's ordered to attack the New Market line and Payne's force is going to cross, they got about 26,000 troops You can see this is deep bottom down here, so they got the James River. This is the bridgehead of deep bottom that had been fortified since June. And they're going to fan out all these guys, 26,000 troops. But Butler made it a point that only the black troops are going to be in the vanguard. So all, so I guess if you were one of these white soldiers down here, you had it lucky because you just kind of sat there and watched everything unfold. Now the problem with that is that Payne is very inexperienced. And for the first attack that happens early in the morning on September 29th, he's only going to send one brigade, and the brigade of Samuel Duncan. So he is the gentleman on the right, far right there. Dashing young guy. And as you can see here, his brigade only consists of the 4th and 6th United States Colored Troops because the other regiment in his brigade was so new that they didn't really even know how to load their muskets. So the 10th U.S. Colored Troops was just basically told to stay home. So 750 men, more or less, are going to make this first attack against the New Market Line. Okay, so the New Market Line itself, the Confederates in there, in the general vicinity, it's going to be around 1,800 troops that are behind these trenches with those obstacles out in front of them. And there's a creek called Four Mile Creek that runs parallel to the trenches that also becomes a natural barrier as well, in addition to the slashing and abattis, the wooden obstacles. So there's a lot of stuff in their way that they have to negotiate before they can even get to the Confederates to fight them. And this first attack is going to be scheduled for 5:30 in the morning, so it's still dark. So they can't even see really what's happening in front of them. So the table is set, and it doesn't look like things are going to go well for the men of Duncan's brigade. Nonetheless, Duncan is going to go in with his men. The white officers in command of the 4th and 6th USCT went in on horseback, if you can believe that. Yeah. They take heavy casualties, needless to say. So they're going to be out there. Duncan said that he watched his men advance, and the fog of the morning enshrouded them like a mantle of death, he said. So it's very hard to see. But still, the Confederates, the Texans in those trenches were just waking up. They were cooking their breakfast. For some reason, the Texas Brigade had a very long history of their breakfast being interrupted. And a lot of people think that that's why they fought really well, because they were hungry. And they were hangry, I guess, hungry and angry. But it happened once again. So the Confederate pickets who are posted out in front of the New Market Line are going to be alerted to the fact that there are soldiers moving their way. They kind of had a feeling that something was going on because, 26,000 men tend to make a lot of noise. There were boats at deep bottom that were offloading troops. And then you have the sound of troops marching as well, because some of the troops had marched up from Petersburg, Bermuda 100 area. So they find out that there's Union soldiers coming their way. And then they're going to see that not only are these any Union soldiers, these are black Union soldiers, and they are going to run back to the main line shouting, and I can't repeat what they shouted, but Negroes, boys, Negroes, I'll just say that. It's not what they said. So while this is going on, while the skirmishers are kind of getting into line, there's Union skirmishers out there, there's Confederate skirmishers, the Texans are falling back to the main line. There was a young officer in the 6th United States Colored Troops who left a really interesting account of the battle, one of the best accounts, I think, of anybody, because it's really hard to find surviving accounts from USCTs just because so many of them hadn't been taught how to read or write. Unfortunately, if you're studying USCTs, you get it filtered through the lens of the officers oftentimes. But still, it's a great account. He said, right when they're forming up, he says, I know there was a big lot of thinking done by us while we stood there. We knew there was a strong line of Confederates behind their rifle pits. We knew that as soon as we would move forward, they would open fire on us. We knew that the order to go forward would soon be given, but beyond that, what? Would it be death, wounds, or capture? Would it be victory or defeat? Right around that time, as I said, Butler's going to ride up, and he's going to say, your cry when you charge will be, remember Fort Pillow. So Fort Pillow is something that had taken place in April of 1864 in Tennessee, where there was a garrison of black soldiers that were defeated by Nathan Bedford Forrest's cavalry, and they were trying to surrender. And there was a massacre that took place where the Confederates were clubbing and shooting and bayoneting these men who were on their knees with their hands raised trying to surrender. It was a sensation in the press. Those who were against the idea of arming black men and sending them into battle used it as a reason why this shouldn't happen. But Butler kind of wants to tap into that anger that the black soldiers felt, that they knew that this could easily happen to them. So what what better motivation can there be other than if you don't win, they're going to kill you? So he says, remember Fort Pillow, and then, as I said, he rides back. And then Duncan gives the order forward. The officers go in on horseback. Duncan says he watched his men disappear as they entered the fog that enwrapped them like a mantle of death. So the Texans, by now, have figured out who's out in front of them. And it's going to take a while for Duncan's men to negotiate all of these obstacles. So the Texans, they left some interesting accounts. Like they weren't afraid to kind of tell it like it was in terms of how they felt about this. As I said, the pickets are stirred, and the Texans are stirred by the idea that there are black men about to fight them. Here's what some of the Texans thought. One guy said, whatever Grant's purpose for using black troops, it was like flaunting a red flag before a mad bull. No man in our old brigade would have retreated from or surrendered to Negroes. That's not what he said. When they charged, the fun began. Another guy said, the word passed along the lines that they were Negroes and to give them lead. Every fellow shot with as much precision as if they were at a shooting match. So when the word spreads out, spreads among the Confederates that there are blacks attacking them, you actually have guys that weren't even manning the line trying to get in on the action. Everybody wanted to shoot at a black soldier. So I think the flaunting a red flag before a mad bull, I think that's pretty much how they felt. So unfortunately for Duncan's men, the first attack is a disaster. No fault of their own, but the deck was stacked against them in terms of the sheer numbers of Confederates in the trenches and the obstacles that they had to overcome. They just didn't have enough men. And they attacked in a line of battle. So it was basically a glorified skirmish line. So the two regiments right next to each other, they didn't have any depth to follow up the attack. Some of them were actually able to get through both of the wooden obstacles and across Four Mile Creek to the Confederate lines, but that didn't last long. So here's another officer's account of how it went. This is from an officer in the 4th USCT, the Maryland Regiment. He said, the 4th and 6th Regiments lead, and as they rush down the incline, receive the concentrated fire of the whole rebel division. The crash of small arms is terrific, a constant roll with the heavier discharges of artillery breaking in like the bass notes of some mighty organ. The air seems full of missiles hissing above, around, and with deadly intent at each one of us. Man after man with the colors goes down, and officer after officer as they snatch the falling staff from between stricken, falling arms. With shouts and cries, with deep-drawn breaths and gasps and choking heart throbs, we plunge on and on, men dropping suddenly or thrown whirling or doubled up as they were struck. Now we reach the brook, which is Four Mile Creek. And we are tearing our way through the brush. What wild music the bullets sing as we force our way along. Keep on, boys, I say. My God, see them reel and stagger and yet still keep coming on. The dense masses of the rebels, their yellow works, are in plain sight. We hear their shouts and cheers, their pitiless, incessant, withering volleys. Surging up to the parapet, our men leap over the lines, and black and white meet hand to hand, no longer as master and slave. And that is an artist's rendition of what this attack was like. It's a painting called Three Medals of Honor by Don Troiani. I actually had the privilege of working with Don on this painting. And it shows Lieutenant Nathan Edgerton of the 6th USCT and then two of his NCOs, both of whom are rescuing the regimental colors and the national colors as well. And you can kind of see what's happening around them. The first sergeant of the 4th USCT, Christian Fleetwood, a name you may be familiar with, he also left an account. He said, "When the charge started, our color guard was complete." Color guard has 13 men, I believe, or 12, I should say. He said, "Only one of the 12 came back on their feet. It was a deadly hailstorm of bullets, sweeping men down as hailstones sweep the leaves from the trees. And it was not long before Sergeant Hilton," it was the color sergeant of the 4th, "also went down, shot through the leg. As he held up the flags, he shouted, 'Boys, save the colors.' Before they could touch the ground, Corporal Veal had seized the blue, or regimental flag, and I, the American flag. It was very evident that there was too much work cut out for our two regiments. We struggled through the two lines of abattis, a few getting through the palisades, but it was sheer madness, and those of us who were able withdrew as best we could." So this attack is going to fizzle out in about 30 minutes, and Duncan is going to lose 387 out of the 750 men that make the attack. Right. Okay, so this kind of gives you a sense of what's coming next. It's going to take a while for the Union commanders to figure out what's going on, but there's a couple things that are happening at the same time. There's an effort to take the Confederate fort at Fort Harrison, which is also part of the lines defending Richmond. That's taking place at the same time. And the sun has also risen so that participants could see what was going on. So Payne is going to basically repeat what he did before. He's going to send in a brigade, Draper's brigade. And he's going to do it a little bit differently. They're going to attack in column. The regiments are stacked behind each other. That gives them a little bit more punching power. And they also have three regiments as opposed to two. So you got a little bit more in terms of the number of men involved. So by this point, the Confederates are sort of starting to watch their flank because they realize that Fort Harrison is under attack. And if Fort Harrison falls and this attack is successful, they're going to be cut off. You're going to have a Union force in between them and Richmond. So that's taking place. So they're getting a little nervous. And then Draper's attack is going to kick off around 7:30 in the morning. And a colonel of the 5th USCT is going to come up, and he's going to address his men, because apparently you couldn't make an attack during the Civil War without an officer giving a speech, or at least saying that he gave a speech later, and what a great speech it was. Giles Shirtliff, he said, "If you are brave soldiers, the stigma denying you full and equal rights of citizenship shall be swept away and your race forever rescued from the cruel prejudice and oppression which have been upon you from the foundation of the government." And that really, I think, speaks to the motivation for what these guys are fighting for, why they're there, and why they're willing to risk their neck, knowing that if the attack fails, they get captured, they're going to be enslaved, or worse. And yet still, they made the attack. So I think that says something. So the way this attack unfolds is very similar to the first, except this time they're going over the same ground that Duncan's men had already crossed, so that they can see the dead and wounded strewn across the entire field as they're marching. Not a very encouraging sight. And they're going to be sort of stuck in the same predicament where they get into the wooden obstructions and it's the natural inclination of any person that's getting shot at to kind of go to ground and want to fire back. So they were ordered to make the attack with the bayonet only, to not fire back at the enemy. The idea is to cover the ground as quickly as possible until you're on top of them and then carry the day with the bayonet. But they disobey orders and they start firing back at the Confederates. Can't say I blame them. But what that's going to do is it's going to stall the attack. And while the attack is stalled, those two artillery regiments, the Richmond Howitzers and the Rockbridge Artillery, are going to be punishing them with explosive rounds that are going to explode over their heads. And then you've got you know, about 1,800 Confederates shooting their muskets at you as well. So once again, the casualties are extreme, but Draper, after what he called 30 minutes of terrible suspense, is finally going to get the officers in line and tell them, you know, get your guys to stop shooting and, you know, get up and get going. So finally, they're able to do that, and with a great cry, they surge out of the wooden obstructions, up over the parapet, and into the Confederate lines. And then it turns into hand-to-hand combat once again. And I have to point out the story of one of the Medal of Honor recipients that was in this attack, just because his story is so crazy. Corporal Miles James of the 36th USCT, during the attack, while they were stalled out in the obstacles, he's only 30 yards from the Confederate line when his arm, he's basically shot in the arm. And they do a battlefield amputation, so it says his arm was, quote, so badly mutilated that immediate amputation was necessary. That's from his Medal of Honor citation. And still, he loaded and discharged his piece with one hand and urged his men forward. That's also from his Medal of Honor citation. I don't know how you do that, because you got to have two hands to, I don't know. But just incredible bravery. And, you know, he's one of the Medal of Honor recipients for urging his men forward is the last part of that citation. And that I really think goes to the heart of, you know, why so many Medals of Honor were awarded for New Market Heights.